Hello, my name is Amy Sturkey. I am a pediatric physical therapist. I'm here with Gray, and we're continuing a conversation. Gray is diagnosed with autism, and he's got just really interesting, to me, perspectives on autism that I wanted to share with y'all. We were talking about your earlier development. Some people with autism develop more typically, and then they have a regression of skills that and then some people do not have that regression and develop a little bit more atypically. Can you tell me about your early development?
Well, first off,
yes,
I sort of said this before with the whole idea of levels, but I don't like the idea of saying that people with autism regress.
Okay.
Because that's not what's going on.
Okay.
They certainly develop differently from people without autism, but there's no regression going on.
Okay. Because some parents tell me that their kids were able to speak and say things, and then they lost their language and weren't speaking anymore. So you don't describe that as a regression.
It's not.
Okay. Tell me how you see it.
See, a lot of people see autism as a deviation from the typical or desired human mind. And what we really see is that, well, autism is indeed different. It doesn't necessarily or even entirely imply that someone with autism is losing something desirable. And this is sort of why I get a bit salty when I hear people calling it a disability, because in a lot of cases, people with autism are just as abled as people without it. They have those abilities expressed in different ways, but they still have them.
Right.
They can still communicate. They just don't do it in the way that we're used to it being done.
Fair. So my gut feel is that language was a strength all along and was a linear progression more in your language, that it continued to progress more complexity over time.
My language was actually complex to begin with.
Really?
Like, most children's first words have one syllable, mine had three.
Wow. What was your first word?
Banana.
Banana was your first word? And how old, do you know how old you were when you started speaking?
Not off the top of my head.
Uh-huh. And so your language has been a strength all along, and has that been a benefit for you then?
Not entirely.
Explain that.
Like, it's... I definitely have... I would definitely say that there have been times that it has benefited me, but there are also times when I overthink things, I pause too much, and I paused. When I say I pause too much, I mean it in the sense that I do so with people who aren't as patient with it.
So you're pausing just the right amount, it's just other people might not be as tolerant of it.
Yes, and...
It sounds like you're really accepting of you.
Yes.
I love that. Tell me what you think causes autism.
No one is sure. We know it's... We know it's hereditary to some extent because family members of people with autism are more likely to have autism, even if they're distant relatives.
Right.
But beyond that, no one knows. It's not caused by any sort of outside influence.
Meaning?
Which means there's no sort of drug or pathogen that causes it.
Okay.
So, the most I or anyone can say is that autism is. It happens, and there's not really anything anyone can do about it other than learn to live with it.
Uh-huh. Fair enough. Do you have particular stims that's true for you?
Yes.
Do you mind sharing what some of those are?
I suppose. There's a sort of a fine line to be drawn, though, between stims and interests.
Okay. Tell me.
Like, I prefer to define stims as something I indulge in to excess with no... And don't get any intellectual benefit from.
Okay, that's an interesting description. Okay, so do you have some of those?
Yes. I like to look at pictures and watch videos of kittens and bunnies and owls. And when I was little, I was interested in things that spun, like ceiling fans and kitchen appliances, and basically anything with wheels.
Huh. Not everyone is as verbal as you are that I have worked with, and I have seen other people who really like things that spin, and I've sometimes said, I wish I could be in their head to see what it is.
It seems to be a recurring thing with people with autism, especially children, I've noticed.
So...
I don't know why it is.
Okay. But it makes you happy to look at them.
It was mostly when I was much younger. It not so much today.
Okay, so it has evolved over time.
Yes.
And so now it's more videos, but of
cute animals.
Well, a lot of people like cute animal videos. I mean, I do.
Not as much as I do, I imagine. I like will watch them for hours.
Okay, I'm way too anxious to do that. And so you said that it was similar to interests. Do you have other interests? You said
interests are the way I see it different from stims.
Right.
In the interests are more intellectually driven, and based on a desire to learn.
So what might be some of those?
So, like, an interest of mine is dinosaurs.
Really?
Because I like to learn about them.
Right.
But that's different from a stim, because I don't stim on them.
Right.
And I think a lot of people, even people who are familiar with autism, get interests and stims mixed up.
Okay.
Or at least conflate them.
Right. Thanks for clearing that up, because that makes sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, this segment has to be done. I really just appreciate your thoughts and the way you can explain things from your point of view. Thank you so much. We'll look forward to seeing you next time. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. If you liked this video and would like to be notified by email when the next video comes out, click the subscribe button here and click the golden bell icon and ensure notifications are enabled on your account.